In 1993, General Magic was one of the most promising tech ventures around. They had huge companies like Apple, Sony, and Motorola backing them, tens of millions of dollars at their disposal, and some of the best people in the industry working for them. They had great plans for mobile touchscreen communications devices and an innovative programming language that would let all types of mobile computers talk to one another easily. But despite all this, just a few years later, most of their partners had left. Their mobile computing dream had become a nightmare, and in 2002, General Magic closed up shop. What happened? This is LGR Tech Tales, where we take a look at noteworthy stories of technological inspiration, failure, and everything in between. This episode tells the tale of one of the most forgotten yet influential companies in mobile technology, General Magic. The story of General Magic begins in 1988 at another company known for throwing around the term magic quite a bit, Apple Computer. Enter one of their new employees, Mr. Mark Porritt, who had founded the Private Satellite Network, or PSN, in 1983. His company built video conferencing and data networks for Fortune 500 companies and various governments, and it was on the back of this success that Apple hired him. Porritt's job was to head up a project for Apple codenamed Paradigm, with the simple goal of building a handheld mobile communications device. But before long, Project Paradigm became far more ambitious. Apple veterans Andy Hertzfeld, the primary software architect for macOS, and Bill Atkinson, the creator of HyperCard, helped take things to the next level. This wasn't going to be just another cell phone like Motorola was already doing with the DynaTAC, nor was it going to be like the still-in-development Apple Newton, a precursor to the personal data assistant. No, the plan here was to put the full power of a personal computer into the hands of the everyday person on the go. Since this was technologically impossible using hardware of the time, they came up with the idea of using a data cloud. By sending software agents to go and roam servers in the cloud and retrieve only the information needed by the user when they needed it, even a low-spec handheld device could perform the tasks of a full-sized PC. With this ambitious project going by the name Pocket Crystal, Mr. Porritt convinced Apple CEO John Sculley that this was so awesome it was worth spinning off the project as a new company. And so in May of 1990, they did exactly that. With $10 million in Apple funding, General Magic was formed in Mountain View, California. They handpicked their own dream team of engineers, programmers, and artists, and got to work straight away on their magical cloud computing platform. And they did this in near complete secrecy, which quickly got industry analysts buzzing. This only increased when in 1992 it was announced that some of the biggest players in the industry had partnered with the company. Not only did they have the support of Apple, but also Sony, Philips, Matsushita, Motorola, and AT&T were all on board the General Magic train. And in 1993, they sort of announced their ambiguous intentions at a press event. That is, to build a powerful software platform and a communications device that would be usable by anyone, anywhere, anytime. Of course, it wasn't actually ready for prime time yet, at all, but why should that stop the showmanship? The bold promises continued with the announcement of the General Magic Alliance. Companies around the globe, such as France Telecom, Cable and Wireless, Toshiba, Sanyo, Mitsubishi, Fujitsu, and many more, were all now partners and investors in the alliance, and by this point the momentum seemed unstoppable. Yet they still didn't have anything to show for it. Well, publicly at least. Internally, the cloud-based agent system, now named Telescript, was coming along nicely. The beauty of Telescript was that it worked with all sorts of operating systems and hardware configurations, ensuring compatibility no matter who manufactured the device. Likewise with Magic Cap, the operating environment designed to be used in conjunction with Telescript. It was somewhat of an evolution of Mac OS, replacing the drop-down menus with room metaphors for each aspect of computing, attempting to make the technology even easier to understand to the casual user. This was actually a popular idea for a while in the 90s and was also infamously used in the ill-fated Microsoft Bob, but that's another story. Anyway, the plan was to incorporate this software into a device between the size of a handheld video camera and a pager, which could connect to cloud servers for computing, as well as talk to other users on the network. And keep in mind, this was early 1993, before the idea of personal data assistance had taken off, and before internet and email really grabbed the public's attention, so the idea was pretty radical. The first devices to use General Magic's designs came from Sony and Motorola, named the Magic Link and the Envoy, respectively. And while they weren't as small as General Magic had hoped, at about 8 inches across and weighing nearly 2 pounds, they incorporated all the major features they promised. You could call and message people, manage spreadsheets, do your taxes, update your calendar and address book, and even use fax services on certain models, all with a graphical touchscreen interface communicating with the cloud. And although the idea went over well with reviewers, consumers weren't so accepting. For one thing, at around $1,000 in 1994, these were nowhere near cheap enough to achieve widespread adoption. Making this worse was the fact that they only communicated using AT&T's Personal Link Network for the first 2.5 years, limiting users even further and confusing people who thought this was supposed to be more open and accessible. Beyond this, the infrastructure for wireless digital communication just wasn't there yet, so most Magic Cap devices relied on a 2400 baud modem and a phone line, while others used the even slower and more expensive Ardis cellular network. Still, the potential for the future seemed huge, and the company went public in 1995, with an IPO valuing them at $600 million. But then something happened during this time that threw everyone for a loop. The internet. With browser software like NCSA Mosaic and Netscape Navigator letting everyday computer users connect to the World Wide Web for the first time, startups and tech giants alike went into a frenzy to capitalize on this exciting new thing. But that meant that General Magic lost a lot of key people in rapid succession, including co-founders Bill Atkinson and Mark Porritt, not to mention business partners who decided the internet was the safer bet. Because web browsers let you easily share information with people around the world, and it was far more ubiquitous and accessible, which made proprietary networks like General Magic's pretty unappealing. Then in early 1996, AT&T completely abandoned Personal Link, leaving Magic Cap devices with no communication options. And on top of that, the introduction of the Palm Pilot and Palm OS had quickly made the Magic Cap OS obsolete. So General Magic quickly decided to shift gears from their own proprietary systems to develop for the internet on other systems, and even made Telescript an open language, but it was just not enough. They had simultaneously started too early, and were too late to ride the wave of the internet, and as such had burned millions upon millions of dollars while earning back relatively little. By 1997, Magic Cap devices ceased production, and by 1999 their performance on the stock market was unpredictable at best. Research and development at the company was halted that year as well, although there was one last hurrah before the end. It was called Portico, a voice recognition-based personal assistant service used in products like Palm's Connected Organizer and Microsoft's Outlook. This soon spun off into another product called OnStar Virtual Advisor, developed for General Motors to add voice recognition capability to their vehicles. But after this short reprieve, there was little left going for General Magic, leading to a bankruptcy declaration in 2002. The OnStar assets were turned over to General Motors, and their other remaining patents were auctioned off in court. General Magic is a classic tale of a great idea at the wrong time. And while their own products never saw the success their investors hoped for, the ideas and the people behind them saw all kinds of success. General Magic systems architect Tony Fadell went on to lead development for the first Apple iPod and iPhone. Engineer Andy Rubin went on to co-found Android and work for Google. Pierre Omidyar went on to start the online auctioning giant eBay. And pretty much everyone else is still some kind of awesome tech guru of some kind and doing cool things. And of course, General Magic's technology laid the groundwork for cloud computing and smartphones as we know them today. So while the company may be a largely forgotten tragedy, it's more than likely that the device you're watching this video on owes some part of its existence to General Magic. And And I hope you enjoyed this episode of LGR Tech Tales. My apologies for the re-upload, but I had to switch some things around due to copyright concerns and legal people advising me to do that. So, you know, I gotta do what I gotta do. Oh, also, I think it's worth mentioning that there is another company known as General Magic nowadays, but they are not really related to the General Magic that I talked about here. They just happen to take on the name because they like what it represents and all that, but they do different products, so don't get confused if you ever see them. And as always, thank you very much for watching LGR.